I think this time it's working. I think I'm properly live right now. I think it's working. Sorry for the tech issues. I don't know what I don't know what was going on there. But I think it's working, right? I mean, I think people can hear me. It's not really my fault. It's just weird service in this area. I don't know. It's just a weird thing. Okay, I'm gonna wait for people to connect. I think it's way smoother now. Tell me if it's not. But it wasn't even working before. And if you can hear me, that's at least something. That's at least something suggesting that the situation has improved. Okay, I've got a bunch of stories to tell you about, and I'll tell you about some of the things going on our Reddit discussion forum. I'll tell you about things coming up on the show. We're doing a segment where Pat and I are going to do our DNA tests. And I have a picture on my Instagram account. If you don't follow me on Instagram, by the way, David.Pakman on Instagram, please do. You'll notice that there's something unusual about the picture I posted regarding the DNA tests that I'm going to be doing. And what's unusual is that there's not just one DNA test, okay? So check that picture out at David Pakman, at David.Pakman on Instagram. And please follow me there, by the way. And there may be a discussion about this on our Reddit discussion forum at davidpakman.com/reddit as well, where we're just 4 Reddit subscribers shy of 3,000. So my guess would be by the end of this live stream, we may have 3,000 subscribers on the Reddit discussion forum. So it's every single day is insane. Every single day I wake up, I look at news stories, and something crazy happened at 2, 3, 4, 5 a.m. And that means that we have a lot of stories to choose from on the show, but it also means that sometimes I guess what I would call less urgent stories don't make it onto the show. And it's kind of a shame because less urgent stories are still good stories, important stories in many cases. We try to get to some of them on the bonus show, but we can't always. So a few of the stories I'm looking at for this week, there's a new report about the sort of, I don't call it irony because for me, sometimes the idea of irony is somewhat funny, and there's really not anything particularly funny about this, but there is a new report pointing out that if the Republicare plan that's been most recently proposed by Republicans to replace the Affordable Care Act passes, it will disproportionately be Trump voters who are going to be hurt by it. And it does make perfect sense when you think about it. I mean, here in Massachusetts, for example, we've had something that precedes the Affordable Care Act and exceeds the Affordable Care Act in terms of what it does. And states like Massachusetts, California, what's another good example? I don't know, Connecticut. I mean, a lot of these predominantly progressive states, if Republicare passes and a lot of the ACA provisions go away, states are going to figure out a way to by and large take care of people, and those are going to be disproportionately not Trump voters. Red states that are a complete disaster economically and when it comes to local and state government. In those states, you're going to see governors and state legislators not fix the problems that will be created by the repeal of the Affordable Care Act and potentially the passage of this American Health Care Act or Republicare, call it what you want. So it's going to be disproportionately Republican and Trump voters that will be hurt by the repeal of the Affordable Care Act. And, if you are a more or less rational thinker, you would say, well, Republicans will pay the price for that because you've got a Republican in the White House, you've got a Republican House, a Republican Senate. It stands to reason, that there will be punishment for Republicans in the 2018 midterm or maybe in the 2020 election, depending on how long it even takes to pass this nonsense. But I'm not convinced of that. And Trump sort of suggested this by saying, hey, if we can't pass this, we'll just let Obamacare fail and then talk about how bad it is, and that will be the way to go. We'll blame Democrats. And I think even if the Affordable Care Act is repealed and the American Health Care Act is passed, Republicare, and it's a disaster for people disproportionately in red states, there will still be an attempt, to blame the problems on Democrats. And it may work. It really may work because of the cognitive dissonance and the sort of low information nature of many of these Trump supporters. So I would not count on, I guess is what I'm saying, a disastrous implementation of AHA leading to electoral consequences for Republicans. That's number one. So I'm going to address that on the program on Monday. Also on the program on Monday, I'm going to be talking about the obvious hypocrisy. Donald Trump, during his entire campaign, was talking about how you can't trust jobs numbers, even though once a month the Bureau of Labor Statistics comes out and tells us that the unemployment rate has gone down, that X number of jobs have been created. It's phony, it's fake, you can't believe it. And now that, expectedly, because nothing major has actually changed in terms of policy so far under Donald Trump, economic policy, since President Obama, you've continued to see job creation and a sort of even or trickling down slightly of the unemployment rate. Now Trump is touting numbers that he previously denounced as fake and phony. Very few people are surprised by this double standard. The reality is that nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. Unemployment is measured the exact same way that it was under President Obama. The labor force participation rate, the U3, the U4, the U5, the U6, it's all measured the exact same way. And there's this obvious, just laughable hypocrisy in that now Donald Trump is touting as successes the data reflected in numbers that were fake and phony under Barack Obama. The truth is that we are close to what is economically called full employment. We are in a situation where, yes, we have a labor force participation rate that is historically low, but that's not an objective indicator of a bad economy. And I've said this before and I'll say it again, and I think, well, there's a crazy glare when I lean forward a little bit. Very strange sunlight situation here in the waning hours of sunlight in the northeast of the United States. If you look at the labor force participation, if you are a stay-at-home parent who is able to stay at home because your significant other has a well-paying job as a result of a strong economy, you are considered an indicator of a bad economy, right? Hey, you're out of the labor force. But the reason you're out is the economy is good enough that your significant other has a job that covers the entire family's living expenses. If you are retired, if you're retired because you could afford to retire, you're out of the labor force and part of the bad economy indicated by the labor force participation rate. If you are a high school senior, or even if you're just in college full time and you're choosing not to work because, hey, the economy's good enough that you don't have to work in addition to going to school, that is an indicator of the labor force disaster that Republicans have been touting for a while. So reasonable people can understand that it doesn't really make any sense. And yet, we heard about the labor force participation conspiracy theories up until Donald Trump took over, and now we hear about Donald Trump touting the exact same numbers that were fake and phony under President Obama. Should I close the blinds? I feel like this light is getting a little bit harsh. I'm just going to do that. I'm just going to have to step away for a second. I'm just going to close that up. Hold on. All right. I think that will be sort of better. Wow. There's like an even harsher, look at that. Look at that line of light right on my face. I think we'll be okay. I think this is going to be better for us. I apologize about that. Okay, so we're going to deal with that. Is this thing even on correctly? Man, technical issues today. Okay, we're back on. So we're going to talk about Trump trusting the previously fake, phony jobs numbers, okay? I'm also going to talk about the No Trump Act, as it's been colloquially called. People are saying there's other live streams going. I was not aware of that. If there are other live streams going, they're not going as far as I'm concerned. I can only be doing one live stream at a time. Let me see if there's anything I can do to cut those other streams off. I only see one under live now. I apologize about that if there's some kind of glitch, but I'm only seeing one. Yeah, there's nothing I can cut, unfortunately. So if there's people in some other live stream room, sad, low energy, somebody tell them to come over here. But I think we're up and running now. The No Trump Act. An American, a U.S. congressman has introduced a bill to stop all taxpayer funds from going to any of Donald Trump's businesses. I say good luck, and not good luck because it's a Republican House and Senate. Even if you could get past that, how will we even know if money is going to Donald Trump's businesses? Because there's this just interwoven there's this sort of interdependent network of businesses, some of which are more and less directly connected to Donald Trump. I don't know that even if you could get something like that passed, you could actually do it in a way where it achieves what it claims like it's going, what it's going to achieve. So I'm going to talk more about that on Monday, and we're going to get into detail on that. Let me take a pause here. Big thank you to Sarah Stevens and Joseph Gable, both of whom have signed up for membership at davidpakman.com/membership. We have a coupon code, which is IVoted17, gives you 40% off. You get 100% of the benefits, including the bonus show and the commercial free audio and video streams of the show, etc. 100% of the benefits, but you only pay 60% of the normal membership prices. So please do that. It's the number one funding source for the show, and I really appreciate it. I'll keep doing live shout outs and thank yous to people as they sign up during the stream. And also, please follow me on Instagram, david.pakman, and I've got an interesting picture there. We've got an upcoming segment on the show where we'll be doing DNA tests. Now, I put a picture up related to this on my Instagram, and I hope you'll follow me there. I've been advised of a couple of things as far as these DNA tests go. Number one, we're working with a professional on this DNA test segment in the sense that our great intern, Melody, found experts on DNA genealogy and sort of understanding historically the context of these DNA tests that you can get done that will tell you your lineage. And we found a great DNA expert who then is going to be interviewed on the show. He's going to interpret my DNA results, etc. Okay. Now, what I've been told is, number one, if I am indeed ethnically, basically completely just Ashkenazi Jewish, right? Jews of Eastern European origin. If that is true, the test results are going to be very, very boring. So I've been warned about that. I may not have that much to report to you if that is indeed the case. Number two, the most interesting thing for me for these results would be for there to be something in my ancestry that is unexpected or unusual. And what I think, based on my understanding of my ethnicity as Ashkenazi Jewish, if I were partially black or Indian or maybe Native American, I think that would be pretty interesting. Some people have said to me, David, what if you're actually like Asian, like part Chinese or Japanese or something like that? I actually would not be that surprised by that, because Ashkenazi Jews historically, you know, if you go really east within Russia, you're in Asia, right? You get pretty close to areas where there can be intermixing with Chinese people, etc. So I think that would actually not be that weird. But anyway, so we're going to figure that out. And if you look at my Instagram account, you'll notice that I have two DNA tests from two different companies, and that is not by accident. I'm actually doing two DNA tests, and I'll talk more about that on the show when we actually do it, because it relates to some interesting stuff that we're going to be doing. All right. Big thank you also to Wesley Soriano, who has signed up at davidpakman.com/membership using the coupon code IVoted17. Really, really appreciate that. Let me take a quick look at the chat. Anybody who needs to be banned? There's always a few people who need to be banned, right? I mean, it's the way these live streams work. Sometimes they get banned and sometimes they're allowed to sort of continue. Not really hugely consequential in many cases. but still they get very, very excited when a ban takes place. All right. Also on Monday on the program, other stories that I'm looking at for Monday. I'm going to talk about this idea that Republicans often talk about when it comes to healthcare, which is that we need a free market solution. And free market solutions work. We have very few actual free markets, right? But if you're going to justify a free market solution for something, you need to be able to show that you have sort of a market situation for supply and a market situation for demand. And fundamentally, when you think about the concept of healthcare, healthcare isn't the type of thing where the more healthcare you can afford, the more healthcare you sort of choose to consume. Obviously, we can talk about specifics like cosmetic procedures, sort of more optional medical procedures. But by and large, the demand side for healthcare is the complete opposite of how a market would work, a free market would work. And it is utter nonsense to suggest that healthcare is something that should be offered on a free market basis. It just doesn't make any sense. And there's a couple really good articles about that. Okay, a lot of people seem to want Ryan S. Whoa, as I almost knock over my camera here. A lot of people seem to want Ryan S. to be banned from the chat. What's Ryan S. doing? I don't know. Does Ryan S. actually really need to be banned? Jewy. Not exactly a productive comment, right? I don't know. He's bothering me. I'll admit to you that he's absolutely bothering me, that's for sure. The block button is free. Let me remind you of that. Okay. Also on Monday, I will be talking about, we were one of the first shows to give you the details about one of the many suspicious Russian deaths, and it was actually the death of a Russian ambassador. And I told you, again, very early on, that it was weird that some of the autopsy data was not being released when normally there's a process to request it and you go through that process and you get the autopsy data and the official cause of death. New York City's chief medical examiner has been instructed by the U.S. State Department not to disclose the cause of death of Russia's ambassador to the United Nations. And that's not exactly going to calm down those who believe that there is definitely something very odd in terms of the number of Russian deaths that are going on. So we'll have a full report about that on Monday or maybe at the latest on Tuesday. I will also be talking about drone strikes, and you may know this, you may not know this, but under President Donald Trump, the rate of drone strikes, so obviously it's only been 6 weeks or so since Donald Trump was inaugurated, but the rate of drone strikes under Donald Trump is already outpacing that which we had under President Barack Obama. And the constitutionality of that, of many of those actions under President Obama was questioned by many on the right, so-called constitutional fetishists. And you're not really hearing anything about that from the right currently. So we're going to be talking about that. Will we eventually hear any complaints about that from the so-called constitutional originalists, whatever, I call them constitutional fetishists. We'll be talking about that on Monday as well. We've got a $5 super chat from Isaiah Rowe saying, is there still any chance of Jeff Sessions resigning or is that over? I hate him the most. Oh yeah, I think there's absolutely still a chance of Jeff Sessions resigning. I think that it's very possible that within the next week to 10 days, we're going to have some more news. Now, you may not even have found out about this because it did not get a lot of coverage. But so first, the position from the Attorney General, Jeff Sessions, was no, meetings with Russia, didn't have any. Senator Franken, Senator Leahy, I didn't have any meetings with Russia. Absolutely not. Okay, then it turned out he did have two meetings with the Russian ambassador to the U.S., Sergei Kislyak. This is the same guy that we now know met with a number of Trump officials during the campaign, okay? But there's another layer to that, which is once we found out that Donald Trump met the Russian ambassador at a foreign policy speech, that was the headline, which is absolutely a legitimate headline. But we afterwards found out that Jeff Sessions was there as well, and that was not one of the two events at which it was admitted that Jeff Sessions met with the Russian ambassador. So there was like one story, maybe two stories about this, where, and I was all over this right away, where I said, it appears that the real number of stories is three. Sessions has admitted to two meetings, but it seems that actually there were three meetings. This was an invite-only event. It wasn't, well, there were thousands of people, and yes, Jeff Sessions was there, and yes, Sergei Kislyak, the Russian ambassador, was there. But we don't really know that they met. It was just anybody could show up there. Not true. This was an invite-only event specifically on foreign policy, and it appears as though there were actually three meetings that Jeff Sessions had. I still believe there is a significant possibility that Jeff Sessions will end up resigning. I should raise my chair a little bit just so I'm more at the right place here. Thank you for that super chat, Isaiah. You can send super chats in, I think, in any amount. I guess I'm not totally sure, using the dollar button in the chat window. Big thank you. So I'm doing live shout outs and thank yous for people that sign up for membership at davidpakman.com/membership during the stream. We have a coupon code, which is IVoted17. It's all lowercase and all one word. Gives you 40% off, okay? Big thank you to Susan Trudeau, who signed up at davidpakman.com/membership. And also a big thank you to David Sakicki. If you understand the issue that we're having right now with lack of independent media, homogenous corporate media, fake news, propaganda news, and by fake news, I don't mean just news you disagree with, I mean actual fake news and also propaganda news, I would encourage you to consider signing up at davidpakman.com/membership. We have an entire extra show Monday through Friday. Okay, every day we do 5 members-only shows. Which are available on audio or video formats, whatever you prefer, to paid subscribers. Instead of getting the 3 to 5 minute YouTube clips that we normally do, we do the entire, every day we do an hour show. We give you that hour show minus the commercials, which works out usually to about 51 minutes. Every single day, that's up by about 4:15 p.m. Eastern time for our paid subscribers. The clips publish every 90 minutes starting at 4:30, right? So it's really great. And I encourage you to sign up at davidpakman.com/membership and use the coupon code by all means. IVoted17. We've got a $3.14 super chat from Wes Smoke, who is a member, by the way, and signed up during one of our live streams a couple of weeks ago, saying, "Cheers, David, and thanks for your perspective." Thank you. Thank you for your support very, very much. Sending, as some people are pointing out, pi 3.14. As a super chat. Appreciate that. Okay, upcoming guests on the show. There's a lot of really, really good stuff coming up on the show. Let me pull up our guest list here. And there was a suggestion made, by the way, on our... Let me adjust here. Something's up with my camera. I want to make sure everybody can see me and we can have clarity this evening. There was a suggestion made on our Reddit discussion forum, davidpakman.com/reddit. That I try to get theoretical physicist, astrophysicist rather, Lawrence Krauss back on the show. He's got a new book, etc. He has agreed. And the people have spoken. Well, one person suggested we have Lawrence Krauss back on. I've already reached out to him. He has already agreed to be on the show. It's just a matter now of figuring out what day he can be on. Busy guy. So we are going to make that happen. Next week, we have, it's absolutely fantastic week. So on Monday, we have Julian DeWitt. You might remember those 7 Earth-like planets that were discovered a couple of weeks ago. One of the key people that worked on this was Julian DeWitt, an MIT astronomy researcher. On Monday, we are going to be interviewing Julian DeWitt. How did he find these planets? What's next? When will we figure out if there might be some kind of life? How far are they, et cetera, et cetera. So he's going to be joining me on Monday. Tuesday and Wednesday, we've got a two-part interview with NYU's Matthew Liao. And Matthew Liao is an expert on neuroethics, number one, which is what can technologies like, for example, fMRI tell us about ethics and morality. And a whole bunch of other stuff. It's going to be a really, really interesting conversation. He's done a TED Talk. You can look him up. Matthew Liao, L-I-A-O. And then I think you're really going to like this. On Thursday, we've got a long-form piece on gerrymandering. And this is something that I've been working on with our segment producer, Noah Ferguson. And we're going to be airing that for you on the Thursday program. So that's all going to be really, really great. The following week, we have just as good of a week of interviews. We are going to be interviewing, number one, Jamie Sampson. Jamie Sampson has written a book called How to Think Like a Scientist. And we're going to be talking to him about just basics that every consumer of not only science news specifically, but just of news in general, just the types of questions that you should be asking to be more critical of the news that you get all the time. Okay, so we're going to be interviewing Jamie Sampson. That's going to be on Monday and Tuesday, March 20th and 21st. And then we've got a lot of other great stuff planned as well. Later this month, Chip Berlet. If you're not familiar with Chip Berlet, B-E-R-L-E-T, he is one of the foremost experts and historians on extremist right-wing movements and right-wing use of communication methods, media, airwaves, etc., and an expert on movements like the alt-right. He's awesome. He is someone that I've been reading quoted in a lot of academic books on the extreme right. And one of the things I'm not sure if will be interesting or not to our audience is that black separatist groups, including the Nation of Islam, and also historically, although he's moderated now that he's more in the public eye, but Al Sharpton is someone whose rhetoric is not that, or at least in the 90s, wasn't that dissimilar from that of white nationalist, white supremacist groups in the sort of abstract sense. And academics, interestingly enough, in many ways consider people like Louis Farrakhan, Nation of Islam, Al Sharpton, to be sort of under the same umbrella of separatist type right-wing extremists. They have different rhetoric and they have different scapegoats that they often use. So in any case, suffice it to say, having Chip Berlet on is going to be super, super interesting. And then I'm going even further out now. In April, we're going to be interviewing the great Cass Sunstein, who's someone that I've admired and looked up to for a very long time. Prominent legal scholar, prominent scholar, academic on decision-making and judgment. And I'm super excited to have Cass Sunstein on the show. I think it's really going to be great. So that's some of what we have going on interview-wise coming up on the show. I may have to do another adjustment to this to the shades. Should I just do it? Because this glare on my face is crazy. Let me do that again real quick, and then I'll deal with some of the super chats that are coming in. All right, that should be better. I'm back. That should be better. Ellie sent a $5 super chat saying, do you think Republicans will get on board with impeaching Trump in the future once we see where this administration goes? That question is very, very vague. I think that it's really going to depend on a couple things. And one of those is just personal preservation, Trump's approval rating, and the reality that in 2018, all members of Congress are up for re-election and one-third of the members of the Senate. And I think that Republicans would be smarter to, if they believe that there's a chance Donald Trump would get impeached, they would probably be better served to encourage him to resign. And every time I mention this, people start saying one of two things. Trump's ego would never let him resign, or Trump's embarrassment at getting impeached would get him to resign if he believed he was going to get impeached. I think you can make strong arguments for both. I tend to believe that if Donald Trump was convinced he was going to be impeached, that he would resign, but then couch it as somehow a victory of some kind. He's not going to let, you know, evil Democrats get to him and kick him out, he is resigning to then put Mike Pence in the White House or something like that. That's my sense of it. We have a $6.66 super chat from Stephen Grayer saying nothing other than keep America secular. All right. Thank you very much for that. And I also have a $10 super chat from Isaiah Rowe saying, if you were walking alone outside on a sunny day and someone sprinted towards you, screamed, cuck Jew, and then held his fists up as though readying to fight, how would you react? Well, I would react assuming that this is someone who's deeply, deeply mentally ill. And I would probably, my instinct is to avoid confrontation. So I would probably say something like, I'm sorry, who are you? What are you trying to achieve here? What is it that you're talking about? I would just take my gun out and point my gun at the person. Why not? Right. I mean, that seems I would be legally justified. I would be standing my ground. Is that a joke or not? I guess I don't know. $7.36 super chat from GameFire74. Will conservative values long-term phase out of society? Will people in the 21st century switch from conservative to liberal or vice versa? Okay, so recently, as in the last, couple hundred years, we've seen a move to the left ideologically, big picture. There have been short periods of time when on certain issues, the country as a whole has moved to the right. Big picture, people have been moving to the left. However, politicians in the US, where we have presumably a representative democracy, have not actually been moving to the left in accordance with the broader movement. So look at polling on abortion, look at polling on gay marriage, look at polling on, is it acceptable to tax the very rich to reduce inequality? On all of these issues, the longer trend is a liberalization. That being said, you have movements that, including like what we're seeing under Donald Trump, a movement of regressive populism, where if you have a sort of charismatic pseudo-populist candidate who successfully uses populist rhetoric, but then scapegoats both so-called the risk of tyrannical government and others historically could be anything from brown people, Jews, religious minorities, whoever, you can have, even though if you polled individuals on political issues, you would still see a relatively left movement. You would see the empowerment of a very authoritarian, regressive populist, right-wing sort of regime. So I think that individually, conservative values will continue to phase out, or what is considered conservative will move further and further to the left. That is a very different question than whether you will actually see a move to the left in terms of our representatives. Okay, two very, very different issues. And I think that time will tell. Time will tell as far as that goes. Let's see. We've got a couple other super chats here. Let's see. Isaiah Rowe sent a $15 super chat. What do you think of open carry laws? And do you think it's an effective crime deterrent, as conservatives say? No, I generally don't think so. We can all find news articles of when someone that was open carrying or concealed carrying or whatever, successfully doing some kind of intervention, right? We can all find individual examples of that. But by and large, more guns in more places, I don't believe is something that is going to make people increasingly safe. And I think if you just think about it, think about the Aurora Batman movie theater shooting. Many people said, hey, problem was that was a gun-free zone. They didn't allow guns, so only the bad guys came in with the gun and more guns would have fixed it. You start hearing gunfire in a dark theater. How exactly does having five people in there with a firearm solve the situation if you have one of these incidents? Now, the gun-toting right will say, well, if the perpetrator knew that it wasn't a gun-free zone, they never would have chosen that location to do the gunfire in the first place. You're assuming that someone who's willing to haphazardly start shooting in a movie theater is a rational person. And I would fundamentally disagree with you, okay? And if you think of one person starts shooting, now you've got a good guy with a gun in there who's going to start shooting, I guess, even though it's dark. Now you've got two people shooting. You've got a second or third good guy with a gun. Who do they shoot? I mean, it's dark. You just hear gunfire. Do you shoot in the direction of the bad guy with the gun? Do you shoot in the direction with the good guy with the gun? It's chaos. I think most people who are rational can realize that. We've got a $2 Canadian super chat from Victoria Lynn saying, what do you think about Donald Trump's new travel ban? I've talked about this before. So big picture, I think that it's possible. It's possible that legally speaking, this may not be unconstitutional. I think that the risk here, we'll see ultimately, right? And I agree with states that are challenging this. I think it's, from a pragmatic perspective, it's not going to be a solver of terror. All along, there could have been a strategy from, I say Trump, but really it's probably Bannon or Kushner or whoever, of putting out the initial travel ban may have represented 120% of what the Trump administration actually wanted. It was found unconstitutional. It was suspended, etc. Now Trump comes back with something that's, you know, 85% of the original ban, but may actually be 100% of what he really wanted. There's less outrage because it's less crazy. There's less outrage because it feels like another one of the same stories, and there's a lot of other stuff to talk about, and it might be what Trump wanted all along. So I think from a strategic perspective, that's something we should be thinking about. Ruel James sent a $5 Canadian super chat saying, I work for Jordan Sheridan's new outlet, Truth Against the Machine. Just wondering if you accept applications for interviews or do you hand pick them? Okay, I don't know. I haven't heard about Truth Against the Machine yet. I think Jordan Sheridan is a TYT guy, so I think I know who that is. Wondering if you accept applications for interviews or do you hand pick them? We do both. So when the audience suggests that we do an interview, we take that seriously. When we get pitched by publicists, for example, we look at the subject matter or the book or the guest and we take that seriously. And then also if there's someone I just feel like interviewing, we go out and try to find them. So the process for proposing people for interviews ideally would be you use the contact form at davidpakman.com and we will then receive the information, review it, and if we're interested, we'll get back to you. Okay, let's see. Let me block a couple people. Some pretty good suggestions going on in the chat about who to block. That's always good. We do have, by the way, listen, let me suggest something, by the way. Our two Reddit moderators have been made YouTube moderators as well. But because I usually do these YouTube streams sort of spontaneously, it's kind of hard to if I only have two people that are moderators, have them ready, you know? So if there are people who believe that they would be good moderators, please email me. Okay, so the contact has to be outside of YouTube. Email me. And if you're somebody who's been watching the show for a while or whatever, and we already know you, that's great. That's a wonderful thing. Let me know if you want to be added to the moderator list. All it will allow you to do is delete and or block people from the chat. And it would be great to have more moderator, so that way, ideally, whenever I do one of these live streams, there will be someone who connects and will be able to help a little bit with the blocking as necessary, okay? We've got a new super chat from Andrew Lincourt for $13.37. Of course, the internet lingo for leet, as in elite, saying the ban button is free, baby. That's right. As I've said before, and I'll say it again, the ban button, or the block button rather, is free, and I am not afraid to use it. Thank you for the £5 super chat by Mr. Twazo. No comment, no question, but thank you very much for that. And also, I don't want to forget about our new subscribers at davidpakman.com/membership. Really, thank you. It's just insane. We had in February 523 new paid subscribers to the David Pakman Show. I think the previous record was like 216 or something like that. So we more than doubled new subscribers in February. And I want to thank Tristan Howard, as well as Diego Rivera Gutierrez, as well as Sion Truen and Damian Yee, all of whom have signed up just in the last few minutes at davidpakman.com/membership. And we do have the coupon code I voted 17. It gives you 40% off. This is how we're funded, right? So if you believe in the importance of alternatives to corporate media, if you have the finances for it, it's great to also support it financially. And we've got some really, really great new stuff coming up on the program. I don't know if people have noticed, by the way, but we've got all new graphics and backgrounds on the show, which we debuted over the last week. Those were developed by David Pakman show viewer Jeremy Pazensky. We also instituted a new, we've got sort of like a wide shot of the studio that we're adding in. It's like a slight behind the scenes type shot that we're using coming into and going out of segments, and a lot of people like that as well. And I've got a meeting next week in our studio with none other than Ben Dixon, host of the Benjamin Dixon program, because people may or may not know. If you've not heard of Ben, by the way, make sure you're following him on YouTube. But Ben actually shoots his show out of our studio, and together we are looking at making some significant improvements to the studio and a lot of really, really exciting stuff. $5 super chat from Jennifer Karain or Kirani. I'm not sure how it's pronounced. Newish member here. Do you ever do meet and greets with members? We've done some fan meetups. Like we did one at Netroots Nation along with TYT and Sam Cedar and Jay Tomlinson from Best of the Left podcast. And it was pretty well attended. I think that was in Detroit a couple years ago. Or was it in Providence? I think it was in Detroit. I'd like to do more events, and this is something that that I think is... It would be cool to do. The logistics can get somewhat complicated sometimes. But yeah, I would like to do more, and obviously, you know, we want to have some level of control as to who shows up. Restricting it to members would be an idea, but the problem is, our member base may not be big enough in any one city where we would have a reasonable audience if it was just restricted to members or something like that. So we've got to figure out, I think, the logistics of it. Yeah, but it's a very, very interesting idea. Okay, so we have so many people signing up at davidpakman.com/membership, by the way. Thank you to everybody who has been signing up. This includes Alan Crowell. This includes also now Lena Stoy and Brittany Witt and the half dozen or more other people whose names I mentioned earlier. We have a 40% discount code. It's IVoted17. There's no requirement to use it. It's just if you want to save 40%, you use the code and you'll get instant access to all the great stuff that we do, including the bonus show. And we've revealed some other upcoming stuff about the show also on recent bonus shows. $5 super chat from Ellie. Thank you for answering my question and thank you for always giving sound feedback to your audience. We appreciate you. Well, thank you very much, Ellie. It's always good to get some positive feedback in the midst of a lot of trolling. People asking how to sign up. You go to davidpakman.com/membership, and it's a pretty intuitive process from that step, from that point forward. And there will be a point at which you are prompted for a coupon code if you want to use one. And you can use the coupon code IVoted17 to save 40%. We've got a $6.27 super chat from GameFire74 saying, do you think there's a student loan debt bubble like the housing bubble that caused the Great Recession? Yeah, there is a problem. So how do you even start to tackle such a complex issue as the student loan issue? I think that if by bubble you mean we may be getting to a point at which it's going to become sort of untenable economically, and you're going to start seeing basically just the writing off of loans. We are probably already there, and you're already seeing it. And the way in which debt consolidation, not scams necessarily, but businesses are taking advantage of people in many ways, and a lot of these other aspects, sort of pseudo-lending industries are indicative of that. But this is a controversial idea, but for many people, there's this instinct that it shouldn't be so easy to get student loans because you might be going into a field, you might be taking out a loan to get a degree in a field where your earnings potential may not correspond to the amount of loan that you're taking out, right? And this is controversial for a number of reasons, not the least of which, you don't necessarily want to discourage people just because you're not likely to earn a lot of money in a particular field doesn't mean that it's not a worthwhile field. And if you make it more difficult to get student loans for those fields, you're going to further see those fields underrepresented in terms of good people. At the same time, if you're in a field where the likely peak lifetime earnings are $60,000 a year, for example, at the end of your career, does it make sense for someone to take on to be so easily able to take on $160,000 in debt to get a degree in that field? This all relates to broader systemic issues, including the explosion of tuition rates, just so many other issues. So it's a pretty complicated thing. But yeah, I think that there absolutely may well be a so-called bubble of sorts going on. All right, on that note, 45 minutes, I'm going to wrap things up. Please sign up, davidpakman.com/membership. The coupon code is IVoted17. It's bigly tremendous. There is really nothing better I can think of than signing up on our website. Support media. Appreciate everybody who watched today. We'll do another stream very soon.